So at this time, I'd like to call Watson Watson. Watson Watson is our advisor, but not only that, she is a heart transplant recipient. She's very dear to us.
Thank you all. I'm very glad to be here, obviously. This year will be my 10th anniversary. They told me when I got the transplant, I'm 25 years, so I've doubled it. So let me tell you about Dr. Fergus, and I'm not going to tell you all about her because I could go on for a long, long time. I met her a few times, and we have a lot of connection that she probably doesn't even know about. But Dr. Fergus is an associate professor of medicine and director of cardiovascular disparities at Mount Sinai now. Prior to that, she served as chief of division of cardiology at Harlem Hospital. That's where I met her. And she probably doesn't even know my donor passed away at Harlem Hospital. In his passing, he saved five of us, not just me. She did her undergraduate work at Barnard College of Columbia University, where I also went. And she completed her college cardiology fellowship at Weill Cornell Medical Center. She's board certified internal medicine and cardiology. I also am happy to know that I met her also at Go Red for Women on Women's Day when she was there. She's an awesome person, obviously. And it's really great to see two things, a woman cardiologist and a black woman.
One by one, tell you the name and what risk factors they're managing. Nelson. I'm a director of meetings, and I am managing my nutrition.
Good evening. My name is Mary Lynn Nicholas Brewster. I'm an attorney. I'm the executive director of the Franklin H. Williams Judicial Commission, and I am managing my cholesterol.
My name is Helen Austin. I'm OBGYN, and I manage my physical activity.
Good evening. I'm Caroline Madison. I'm a nurse practitioner in advanced heart failure and transplant, and manage my blood sugar.
Good evening. My name is Hope Wade. I am a fashion designer. I own my own company, Hope Wade Designs, and I'm the producer of Rockwood Fashion Week. And I handle my emotional health.
Good evening. My name is Andrew O'Sullivan. I'm a banker. And I manage my...
Cheese and grease, your triglycerides go up. But this one you know, the LDL. What should the LDL be? The LDL.
It should be low.
It should be low. It should be low. You want it to be low. Remember, low density lipoprotein, low class, you want it to be low. It's the really sticky stuff that clogs the arteries. And you want that to be 100 or less. Okay, and in people who have a heart condition, we try to get it closer to 70. But there's one more that we measure, and it's called the
HDL.
And very important, especially for women, because if it's high in women, it kind of, you know, diminishes the other one. So the HDL should be what for women? Anybody knows the answer? 50 or higher, okay? So those are your cholesterol numbers. So if you don't know those numbers, you should know them. Now, how about blood sugar? Who said they were managing their blood sugar? Was that you, Caroline?
Yes, I did.
Okay, so she's managing it. What should be your fasting blood sugar? That means your blood sugar when you wake up first thing in the morning and you didn't eat, or 4 hours of not eating, it should be what?
100.
100 or less. Now, here's a trick question. If your blood pressure is low on a particular day, that's all good. When you go to the doctor and you do your finger stick or you do your blood sugar, right? But you could have cheated last week, or you could have been cheated the entire week before, having candies and sweets and all kinds of things. So what is the thing that you measure to know how good it is all along? Yes, your hemoglobin A1C. Or as they say, the glycosylated hemoglobin. What that is? Basically, it's your red blood cells coated with sugar. And when it's coated with sugar, it's not going to work. So does anybody know what your A1C should be?
5.3.
Okay. It should be 5.3, but you want it to be less than 6. Okay? So if it's getting any higher than 6, you have a condition called what? Prediabetes, right? So in the doctor's office, you want to measure it. You want to make sure you check this out and have your A1C as close to 5 as possible, but definitely less than 6. What other risk factors did we talk about?
Emotional health.
We talked about emotional health and we talked about stress. Believe it or not, those two can kill you, right? Someone said stress can kill you. You know, your emotional wellness has to be in place. So depression has been linked independently with heart disease, when controlled for age, sex, race, diabetes, hypertension, high cholesterol. There's a study called the Women's Health Initiative, and it shows that if you're depressed, it increases your likelihood of having heart disease. So depression, manage it. You make sure that you find alternative solutions, make sure you see the doctor, make sure you do fun things like meditation, you know, dancing, laughing, you know, doing things not to be depression. And the same thing for stress. Stress increases these substances called catecholamines, so they increase your heart rate and your blood pressure. So if someone's stressing you out at work or at home, you need to manage that. There's literature and research done at Harvard in a paper that was submitted last year that showed 44% of people have work stress. Is that you?
Yeah.
Is that you? I like to tell this one statistics because I think it's so important. So this is a true, and you can look it up. It's the Stockholm study for women. It says that if a woman is married and she's married unhappily or with a partner and she's unhappy, it increases her risk for having heart disease. For men, they just need to be with a partner. Does not increase their risk for heart disease. And for single women, it did not increase the risk for heart disease. They have to be in an unhappy relationship. Look this up, Stockholm study. So women, make sure if you're in a relationship, it has to be a happy one. Men, just enjoy your relationship. Okay, what other risk factors? Obviously, don't smoke. We talked about that. We talked about nutrition. So our friend, my sore, Dina Nelson, manages her nutrition. All right? So you gotta watch what you put into your mouth. because it can affect your blood pressure, your blood sugar, and your cholesterol, right? So, how many people can tell me how many grams of sodium are you supposed to be eating per day? I wish I had a gift to give away to that person who answers that. Do you know how many grams of sodium or milligrams that you should be consuming?
Less than 2 grams.
Oh, well, you know the answer.
Oh, I'm a fashion designer.
Yeah, so the general public, your call is 2.3 grams of 2300 or less. Aim for 2,000 or 2 grams. But if you already have hypertension, and in particular, people of the African diaspora, so people of color, they should try to aim closer for 1,500 milligrams or 1.5. And with that, you can drop your blood pressure by 5 millimeters of mercury per day. Ever heard of the DASH diet?
Yes.
You can also manage, that tells you things to eat and how to reduce your sodium, okay? Also, according to your activity and as you get older, you should be watching the amount of milligrams of food, the amount of calories that you're ingesting per day. Okay, so if you're going to be working out and exercising as our good friend Dr. Holston over there, so then you could eat more, right, and burn it up. So you should be aiming for about 2,000 milligrams, more or less, if you're going to be working out and exercising. Obviously, males, they'll be able to eat more, but then you could go a little bit higher. But if you're going to be sedentary, you should be aiming for less, even like 1,800 a day or less, okay? What other risk factors, guys? Did we miss anything?
Smoking
is the lowest hanging fruit in terms of if you don't smoke, you can survive. What does smoking do? It makes your blood thick. It increases the risk of forming a clot. It increases your risk of arrhythmias. I'm sure you all have heard of atrial fibrillation. It increases your risk of ischemia, or having a heart attack. So don't smoke. It also causes lung disease. So you can get emphysema, COPD. So obviously, don't smoke. Right now, we have a lot of kids who are vaping, right? And so now they've gone from smoking to vaping. Is vaping good for you?
No.
No. Vaping can cause very bad lung disease. So avoid smoking, vaping, or e-cigarettes. They're all the same. Okay, so the bottom line, let's see, we did everybody at the table. My husband, who's Ronald Rowe, he said he was going to manage his blood pressure. So does everybody, how many people here have their blood pressure measured? Raise your hand if you know what your blood pressure is. Okay, those people down there not raising their blood in their hands. What's an ideal blood pressure? What's a good blood pressure?
130.
Okay, very good. Once you get to 130 over 90, you have high blood pressure. Okay, now, can your blood pressure go up on a particular day? Yes, because, you know, maybe you ate the wrong thing, or maybe you're stressed out at work, or maybe your kids got to you, or maybe you didn't sleep, or maybe you had a couple glasses of alcohol at a dinner party. But if it's consistently above 130 over 90, that's bad. You need to be on a medication, you need to be managing it, or you need to do a lot of different things. You know, watching your sodium, taking your meds, getting sleep to bring it down. Okay, so those are your risk factors. Yes? Do you have a question?
If you don't say to have an occasional cigar.
Say it again?
Is it okay to have an occasional cigar?
He's joking with me. Yeah. No. I don't allow him to smoke cigars. He may do it when I'm not around. Smoking's not good for anything. But anyway, so those are your risk factors. Remember, heart disease is 80% preventable. Treat your heart like a Valentine. And manage all of these risk factors. Ladies and gentlemen, it's been lovely talking to you. Have a great evening.